But would it take 3m times what would give me 9m to the 7th?
3m
to the 6th. What would this have to be so that 3m times this thing? And it would be double check it in your own mind. 3m times that, is that 9m to the 7th? 3m times negative n. L makes it negative, and n times n is n squared. But look at these two terms, this one and that one right there, inside the parentheses. What do they both have?
M's.
They have m's too.
So it would be 2.
M squared. That gets an m and another m. So here, let's just make this m squared that we took out. That'll make this m to the what?
Fifth.
So that m squared turns into the fifth of the 7th. What would that make this?
That would make m to the 2nd.
This would be
m
to
no.
the 3rd.
1?
1?
No, it's the 10.
The 3rd? But think about what's happening here. We're going to multiply 3m squared by this.
Yeah.
Or 3m squared by negative by negative n is cubed.
You just don't put...
Just say one, guys.
Shelby's gonna stop. Tunnel snakes
forever. I've had Shelby's a lot of fun to play like co-op games with.
Oh jeez.
Gotcha, Shelby.
Just give me the controller. I'll be
I'm gonna come over to your house and grab your controller and play for you.
Okay.
So
3m squared times 3m to the 5th. Yes, 9m to the 7th. And this is just the negative version of 3m squared, which is exactly what you would get if you multiply 3m squared by a negative 1. Just makes it negative. It's exactly that. Okay. So that's called factoring a common monomial. There it is, a monomial that they have in common. One term that they all have.
Yep.
Next up is solving this equation, and then we'll factor out more factoring. Okay, when we're solving these equations, for quite a long time in this class, in an algebra class, we need one side of the equation to be zero. It's not kind of there's one method for solving these equations that doesn't require the other side to be zero, but we're not there yet. So for now, it's a good enough rule of thumb to say, if one of the sides of the equation is not zero, make it zero. So how do we do that? How can we make, let's go for the right side. How do we make the right side zero?
Divide by, times it by zero?
Okay, multiply by zero, but then we have to multiply this side by zero, we get zero equals zero, and
okay.
Oh, we didn't find out what it is.
Do you subtract 3h? Yes.
Subtract, well, we gotta subtract some h's from h's, right? And if we subtract all of these h's from these three h's, we'll have more h's, we'll have zero. So keep in mind these are not like terms, so we're not gonna try and put those together.
No.
Create 6h squared minus 3h equals, that's, is a zero.
Yeah.
So now we use our factoring skills, the same kind of factoring skills we just used. Factor out a monomial. What do these two have in common? The biggest thing they have in common.
H, 3.
And also a 3. So a 3 and an H, we can pull out of both of these. So that gives us what here? 3H times 6.
2H. 2H.
2H, done. 3H times 2H is 6H squared. 3H times this thing will be negative 3H.
Minus 1.
Minus 1, just like before. All right, you may know what you're supposed to do next, but I also want you to, I want this to click with everybody, this to make sense, okay? It's exciting when it clicks and it makes sense for that one new person each day, so pay close attention here as to why this is happening, 3h equals 0, or 2h minus 1 equals 0. That's something we always do. Once we get it to look like something times something equals 0, we always set the left thing equals 0 and the right thing equals 0. anybody explain why that is? Why we set this thing equal to zero and that thing equal to zero?
Because, either, it's a good one there. Well, it's going to be like that because A or B has to be zero if it always equals zero.
So you're referring to this. A times B equals zero. And A and B are just representing a number. Some mystery number times some other mystery number equals zero, okay? And we don't know for sure which one is zero, or even maybe both of them are zero, but definitely one, at least one of them has to be zero, right? The other option is for them to both not be zero, which would never give you a zero when you multiply. Mm-hmm. And one times two, nope, not zero. It has to be zero times something, or something times zero, and that's what we have here. We have a number, mystery number, times another mystery number. Do you see that as two, just two numbers? The one on the left there, 3h, is getting multiplied by this other one on the right, 2h minus 1.
Yeah, yeah, I'm good.
Just put that in the pocket.
I don't have any.
The crumpled up piece of paper that was just in your hand?
Oh, that was just a piece of paper. I was just from this.
Are you getting ready to throw before I looked at you?
That was going
to
hit Jason.
Wow.
So
let's
not.
Let me see if edited it.
Okay, so that's what we have going on here. One of these two things, this guy here, that guy here, one of them has to be zero. If neither one of them was zero, never get a product of zero. Okay?
Again.
Again, explain it again?
No, one more problem.
3h equals 0, divide by 3 on both sides, h is 0. 2h minus 1 equals 0, add 1 to both sides, 2h equals 1. Divide by 2 on both sides, h equals 1, divide by 2 on half. So we found them. We found the values of h that would make a 0. Obviously, we put 0 right there, and that h is going to be 3 times 0 times. I wouldn't even bother figuring that out, because times 0 is going to give me 0. If we put a 1 half right there, 1 half times 2 is 1, and 1 minus 1 is 0, and so now this entire parentheses is 0, and 0 times that will be 0.
H has to be 0.
H has to be 0, or H has to be 1 half.
Okay.
Another one. Another one.
We'll have more equation solving today. Don't you fret.
Oh my god, no one cares, Pampers.
This one, we're going to factor it.
Okay.
I'm going to change this to x.
What? I already wrote p.
I'm sorry. When we're learning something new like this, it's helpful to just call it good old x. So x squared plus 20x plus 64, we've gotten that so many times. Like in the, I think you just took a test. I think the test part of the quest, it was the quiz part of the quest, was multiplying stuff together, right? Multiplying polynomials together. And this product had to have come from one parenthesis times another parenthesis. Here's some stuff we know for sure that's just really obvious. If I was to multiply two parentheses together and wind up with an x squared, that must have come from multiplying an x by an x. Right? Must have been what happened. Multiplying an x by an x. Something else that you'll notice is that this 64, whenever you multiply parentheses together like this, that last number always came from this number times this number.
Right?
Yeah. Agree?
Hold on,
X times x gives us the x squared, and that number times that number always gives us this
yep.
number. It's that middle part that kind of throws a wrench in the gears.
The middle part is just adding them.
The middle part is just adding them. The middle part is kind of the deciding thing. It takes a little more work. It's easy to see that x times x is x squared, and this times this is 64. And then we just got to make sure it adds up to 20.
I got it.
So I'm just gonna throw in random things here. 8 and 8. Do 8 and 8 multiply to 64?
Yes, but they don't add up to it.
So what happens? X times X is X squared. Let's jump to the end. 8 times 8 is 64. In the middle, though, I get 8x and another 8x. And that's x squared plus 16x plus 64. That didn't work, so we abandon that plan. We try again with x and x and two other numbers. So what two numbers multiply to 64 and also add to 20?
4 and 16.
4 and 16.
Mm-hmm.
X times x is x squared. X times 16 is 16x. 4 times x is 4x, and 4 times 16. Of course, it wouldn't have made a lot of sense to choose two numbers that didn't multiply to 64. 16x plus 4x is 20x. 20x. X squared. Who would like to see another example before I ask you to do one on your own and turn it into be graded? You want to see another one?
Yes.
Okay.
Let's do another one.
X squared minus 4x minus 12. X squared minus 4x minus 12. All right, so let's start with the things that are really clear, really obvious, that for first things first, x squared comes from x times x. So we can just fill those in. Right?
I was trying the hardest part.
I can just carve that in stone, because there's no way I'm going to have to erase that and fix it. It's absolutely 100% correct.
Okay, you got a pickaxe?
What's that?
So carve in stone, you got a pickaxe?
Let's pull up on that. We could. We are not going to. Also, this number, when I multiply this number by that number, what do I know I'm going to get?
Whoa.
Almost?
48.
Negative 12. How do I multiply two numbers together and get a negative number?
Negative plus positive times.
Negative times a positive. Something else we could carve in stone, another we'll never have to fix, because it absolutely has to be a negative times a positive.
Six into
10.
Okay,
you're wrong.
Wait,
what are
you?
You're raising your hand. Negative 6, positive 2.
Yes.
Yeah. Are there some other combinations we could have tried? It could have been, what about x minus 4 and x plus 3?
It doesn't add up. It's only a negative 1 at the end.
That adds up to a negative 1x if you multiply it all out. Okay. So this is going to get multiplied by x, and this is going to get multiplied by x. You know, you can just add negative 4 and 3 and see what the middle term is going to be. It's going to be negative 1. Negative 4 plus 2, negative 1, x. So x squared minus 1x minus 12. That's not what I was looking for. I was looking for negative 4x.
Russian.
Okay. You ready to show you know what you're doing here?
Yes.
Where's the
test? Okay, wait. Is it always going to be? Is there always going to be the x's in those spots? Always.
X's in those spots. This x and this x? As long as this is a 1x squared, yeah.
Okay. It could be an s, though.
Well, it could be an s.
But then it'd be a 6 squared.
S.
Yeah.
SOS squared.
Save our ship times 2.
Save our ship times 2.
Save our ship times itself.
Yeah, times itself. Save our ship times.
Save our ship. Does that mean you bring multiple supplies to save?
Okay. Well. Let's get a blank sheet of paper. Just one question. One question.
You're killing a tree.
So paper comes from trees that are grown specifically to be paper. So
it was their destiny. Besides, you get recycled anyway.
You're not killing a tree. You're helping a tree meet its destiny.
Yeah, let's use it.
You're not killing the tree. You're letting it.
I made it. We got too much ozone. I'm gonna burn it.
You're letting it be what it can be, instead of what it can't.
I like when we have lots of time to work on homework, which means we need more time at the end, which means we need to get through the lesson, which means we need to get through this.
Yeah.
Just
tell us what we need to do and just stop being honest and just, you don't worry.
No, thanks.
Stop harm on that one.
Okay, let's go with. X squared minus 10x plus 1.
Are you sure there wasn't an x in the one?
Okay. So, ready to be pointed out? We're going to start out with two x's. X there, x there. So, next is x squared. Next thing we know is this number. Is in at some point in the multiplying of these two parentheses going to get multiplied by this number?
21.
And it's going to be 21. So we're limiting the numbers that we put there to numbers that multiply to positive 21. We also know that they're also each going to get multiplied by these opposite x's here.
And we add them together, which equals negative 10.
So when you add them together, so they should equal negative 10. Well, so at least I know if they're going to add to a negative number when I add them, and they're going to multiply to a positive number when I multiply them, they should both be
negatives.
Right? That much I'll never erase. I'll never be wrong about that. But now I have to figure out which numbers go in.
Numbers are easy.
-3, -7.
Because
it's true.
A lot of possibilities.
1 and 21 is the only other thing you can multiply. So, you know, it's not that.
If it was 1 and 21, then that would need to be
negative
22.
So
only
7.
Can we do another one?
Sure.
Because that's like easy and I just didn't get it.
Okay, let's throw another one up there. X squared. Let's see. Minus 8x plus 12. So again, we have x here, x there. We have two numbers. They're going to multiply to 12. They're going to add to negative 8. So they're going to multiply to a positive and add to a negative, which means they are
both negatives.
Both negatives.
Oh my God.
It's a nice thing to do. It's like something like I said, you can carve it in stone. If you're absolutely certain that will never be wrong. Now we kind of do. 6 and 2. I use 12 because there's 6 and 2, 3 and 4, 12 and 1, right? There's lots of options. But 6 and 2 are the only combination where if I were to multiply it out, I get x squared minus 2x minus 6x plus 12 and negative 2x and negative 6x adds a negative 8x like we want. That's it. Keep in mind, this is not your answer. If that was the question, you'd be surprised how many times somebody will factor correctly, multiply it back out, write this as their answer. That was the question. I don't need to know that. I need to know that. So let's see if you know that is what I'm looking for. Men? All right. Back it up. Because this works great for talking about what we're talking about today. So we're going to use this skill to solve equations. It's very similar to the equations we solved as we were talking about the homework. If this equals 0, okay, so that's like that's what we start with, then we factor the left side, as we just did, still equal to 0. The right side of the equation is still 0. And so what we've done, I like to imagine the first person who did this in history just felt pretty proud of himself. He was pretty clever. This equation is very difficult to figure out what in the world would x be. I could guess around and figure it out eventually, but I wouldn't want to do that every time. By factoring it, though, I turn it into a times b equals 0. Now I know absolutely for certain that either x minus 6 is equal to 0, or x minus 2 is equal to 0. So I took something there in the first line that seems impossible to maybe very difficult at best to just guess what value you're supposed to plug in for x. You'd have to guess not only one value, but two different values of x that would work. But by factoring it, we turn it into one thing times another thing equals zero, so we know one of those two things has to equal zero. Now we set up two really easy to solve equations. You add 6 on both sides, x is 6. Add 2 to both sides, x is 2. And we're done. We found it. We found the solutions, both of them, this equation. We can test them out if we want. 6 squared minus 8 times 6 equals, not equals, plus 12. That should come out to be 0. We got 36 minus 48 plus 12. 36 minus 48 is negative 12 plus 12. Zero. Not sure if anybody appreciates that as much as I do, but it's pretty cool. All right. Let's try another one. So all it takes is this factoring the left side. It should be equal to zero. If it's not equal to zero, make sure you make it that way before you start factoring, otherwise you're going to waste your time. Let's start out with... Let's say that equals zero. Let's solve that equation. First, factor the left side, as we've been doing so many times.
No.
All right, so first we make sure that the right side is zero, which it is. Okay, great. And then we factor the left side. What do we get?
X minus 1.
8 and 2.
Negative 2 and negative 8. Same thing. Both together still, we're going to combine a negative 10x, right? Why
is
it so funny? X minus 8, x minus 2. I'm going to explain this again, and I'll explain
x
it
8,
a thousand times until it clicks with everybody. What we have here is one number times another, and when we multiply two numbers together to get zero, either this first number is zero, or this second number is zero. Now we have two very easy equations to solve. Add 8 on both sides, x equals 8.
Two.
Add 2 on both sides, x is 2.
Woo!
9.
You know, 8, clearly 8 will make this is zero, because if I put 8 right there, 8 minus 8 is zero. What do I do with that zero?
Plug it in and put the equals next to that, and then the zero also. So then,
what I'm saying is,
yeah.
Is what I'm saying. I can see that 8 is a solution because look, here's the equation.
Yes.
And if I plug 8 in there, this is zero.
Mm-hmm.
Zero.
Yes.
And what do we do with that zero?
You times it by 8 minus 8.
By 8 minus 2.
Or 8 minus 2. Right?
And it doesn't, the reason I'm not putting anything there is because it doesn't matter, does it? If I multiply anything by 0, it's going to be 0. And if I do the other thing, I rewrite it and I plug 2 in, and the right parenthesis is going to be 0, and that would come out to be 0 as well. This is a key step here. If you try to jump from there just writing x is 8 and x is 2, you might have noticed, like, oh, there's the opposite of what you see there. If it's x minus 8, then x is 8, and if it's x minus 2, then x is positive 2. That's a really bad habit to get into. Okay. Because we're going to factor more complicated quadratics, we're going to want to get in the habit of writing this factor equals 0, this factor equals 0. Just writing down the opposite thing, then as soon as it's not as obvious, you're going to have to learn this all over again and catch up. Get in the habit of just setting each factor equal to zero and solving, even if solving is as easy as adding 8 to both sides. Right. Let's just let's do another one, but let's throw a little bit of a twist in there. So we learn something, a little something new, but we also get more practice. So the thing about this is, even if I factor the left side, okay, which is possible, I could factor this left side, it will factor. If But then I'll have something times something equals 8. Is that very helpful?
Not really.
Think about something times something equals 8. Can you tell me what those two numbers are?
2, 1, 8, or 4.
What about 1/2 and 16?
2, 1/8, maybe 1/2 or 16.
What about
1/8
and
64? Oh, God.
Well, what about -2 and -4?
Oh, no.
What I'm getting at is there's
64
literally
and 8.
Infinite combinations
negative.
Of an A and a B that multiply to 8. And there's no definitive answer to what A or B is. It's only when A times B equals what?
0.
So we gotta get that right side to be 0. How do I get this side to be 0? Minus 8.
Add it.
What?
Or subtract it to the other side.
So now x squared plus 3x minus -10 - 18 is -18. Now we're ready to go about our business. So if it's not equal to 0, again, make sure it does equal 0. It's 0 on the other side,
no,
otherwise
you're
lost. It's not really going to work.
I think he's going to kill you.
Just this and like really one more thing, and then we'll have time to work on homework.
All right,
so did we get it factored? How does it factor?
It factors and...
-3, and then +6.
Good, getting better at that. Here we go again. See, people aren't listening, so I'm going to explain. Until everybody's listening and doing what I'm saying, I'm not going to stop explaining this. We have one thing, right? One set of parentheses times a second parentheses. So it's the product of just two things. This thing on the left times this thing on the right. And the result... 0, which tells us that this has to be 0, or this has to be 0.
Anyway.
You've gone for like an hour.
What did you say? X equals 3 or -6.
Add 3 to both sides, you get x equals 3. Subtract 6 from both sides, x equals -6. We're going to practice one more time together, but it's just going to, like, the phrase of the question is going to be slightly different.
Wax on, wax off.
Exactly.
Oh my god.
Okay,
so what we have here is a function, f of x equals x squared plus 5x plus 6.
F of x also means y.
F of x means y. It's the same thing as saying y equals x squared plus 5x plus 6.
I'm saying that.
So here's the thing. With a function, there's like limitless possibilities. I can't really solve for x because x could be anything I want it to be. And then when I run all the numbers and do all the arithmetic here, y is just whatever y has to be to match. So there's nothing to solve for right now.
So the
question is, or the request is to find all zeros.
Find all zeros. Oh god.
But it turns out to be exactly the same as doing this problem. Because find all the zeros, it just means that y equals zero. If y equals zero, then what does x have to be? Well, y is 0, right? We make y 0. And look at the equation we have.
No way.
X squared plus 5x plus 6 is 0. And we solve the equation. Quadratic equals 0. Factor, set each of the factors equal to 0 and solve. It's all the same thing. So when you see find all the zeros, all it means is this is a function. X could be anything. Y could just be whatever it needs to be to match up with this other side. Possibilities are limitless. But if we say find all the zeros, we mean that the output is 0, the y value is 0. And we're finding out what x needs to be to cause the output to be 0. So we have
to solve. So when we're saying x equals blank, we're saying f of x equals blank.
When we're saying x equals blank?
No, or is it just still x? We're finding the other x's up to.
Well, I don't know what your question was, and now you're
you
not
don't
asking
need to
it
know.
Anymore.
It's okay. I've answered it myself.
So So find all the zeros just means this. It just means y is zero. You need to make y zero and solve that equation. Just like we've
solve
done
it
so many times. So to do that, we would factor. Can anybody factor this real quick? X and x and what were you throwing there?
Minus 1 plus 6.
Minus 1 plus 6?
Yes, that's what it is.
Let's multiply it out. What's negative 1 times 6?
Oh, just kidding.
That's positive and that's positive.
Yeah.
Probably that's
no,
positive.
No, see, now I'm on
oh.
What do you think?
What the heck?
Two positives?
Oh,
that's two positive.
Positive 2, positive 3. 2 times 3, 6. 2 plus 3, 5.
Okay.
Oh my god.
There it is.
Equals 0. X plus 2 equals 0. X equals negative 2. X plus 3 equals 0. Subtract 3 on both sides. X equals negative 3.
My life has been a lot.